Let me start by saying this. Obviously, to this point in the season, we're excited about where we're at. As you guys have got to know me a little bit, 8-4 isn't good enough. I expected to be 12-0, but on the flip side, we've played the 13th toughest schedule in the country. And to be 8-4, have a couple real quality wins, and protecting our home court to this point, I think has been pretty impressive by our young team. A couple updates on certain situations. Braxton Bonds, his appeal was denied, so he will not get to play this season. He will redshirt and have 4 years of eligibility left. We're disappointed about that, but that's all we can really say on that matter. We had a great semester academically with over 2.5 as a team. Josh and Brandon Lopez are both on target to graduate this spring, which is fantastic for our two seniors. We're down to 9 scholarship players now. We only had 12 to begin with. Dominic Woodson transferred. Jabari McGee broke his foot. We'll probably be out the remainder of the season, although we're not positive about that. And then Ian Childs has aggravated his shoulder. He's really tried to battle and get through that injury all fall, and he's decided it's just too painful to continue, so he will have surgery in the next few weeks, and his season will be over. So we're down to 9 scholarship players as we move forward, but we've had a good intercession break in regard to how we've practiced. Guys have improved, and I think the 9 guys we have are tough, hard-nosed, competitive kids that are excited about league play.
Which shoulder was it with
Childs? Gosh, I should know. I think it's his left shoulder, isn't it, Tom? I don't believe it's his shooting arm. Yeah, so his left.
When did you officially learn about Bonds?
Probably about 3 days ago. What's today? Monday, yes, so I think last Thursday or Friday, Jimmy. Really, they don't really give you an explanation. They just kind of say it's declined, or they give you the waiver. So they don't really explain that. I would think it probably is the fact that he attended class there for 3 days. So that's kind of all I really know on that.
With Childs, I know he's been banged up, but he came back and actually played a little bit.
In practice, you know, and it's one of those things, Ben, where he's been tough and hard-nosed and tried to get through it. I don't know that it was ever getting totally better. He was just trying to play through it. His foot had really bothered him, and that healed up to about 100%. But this shoulder thing continues to linger, and he just doesn't feel like he can get through it. And so he's going to have the surgery probably in the next 2 weeks.
And that was last week when he aggravated? Yes,
yeah.
Is McGee a redshirt candidate?
Yeah, McGee could redshirt. He hasn't played in too many games, so if he doesn't come back, we hope in the next 3 or 4 weeks, which is doubtful, then we'll probably end up redshirting him.
How are you trying to coach around the lack of much of an inside presence?
You know, I think the biggest thing, Jimmy, the way we play defensively with our press back to a zone, that size isn't the most important factor. Certainly you'd like to have more than we have, but you can limit some inside post touches defensively. You can double the post like we do in our zone. So defensively, it's a concern, but not a huge concern. Offensively, you certainly would like to put more pressure on the rim by throwing it inside and drawing fouls or being able to get a good look on the rim, and we just don't have that. So we try to put our bigs and pick and roll situations where they can get their baskets on roll opportunities, or what we call angles to the rim. And then we get them in the short corner box so that when we space the floor like we do, we get dribble drive opportunities. Now their big guys help up. They get an opportunity to kind of play behind the defense to get to the rim. So we just try to, you know, through floor spacing and pick and roll actions, get them their baskets in different ways rather than the conventional throw it to the post and let a guy, you know, go to work from 6 or 8 feet. We just don't have that luxury. I do think our big guys in time will be able to do that, but not this season.
Coach, what's your impression of the SEC as a whole as you head into league play?
Well, you know, I've had the chance to see probably everyone in our league play at least a couple times. I think without question from what I've heard that this is the best the league's been in a few years, top to bottom. When you look at teams around the league that maybe have been in the bottom tier of the league having great seasons, you know, South Carolina's having a great year. Mississippi State just beat a really good Florida State team. So I think with the exception of Kentucky, you probably have, you know, 17 other games that you could lose all 17 or you could win all 17. It's going to be that balanced and that small a margin. So our team has to be tough. We have to play with detail. We have to end possessions on both sides of the ball, defensively with blockouts and two-hand rebounds, offensively playing without turning it over and getting good, clean looks to the rim. And if you do that, you'll give yourself a chance. But our league is very good, and it's good top to bottom this season. Not really. I think, you know, our team kind of knows what others think of it. And, you know, we've talked about expectations only matter with the people in our locker room, our players and our coaches. And outside of that, whether it's individually or as a team, no one's opinion really matters. We've got to continue to improve every day, individually as players, individually as coaches, and then collectively our team will get better, you know, and all those prognosticators and guys that pick you here or there, it really doesn't matter if we do what we're supposed to do.
Donnie, why do you think you were fouling so much earlier, and what has led you to reducing the number of fouls recently?
Well, it's been a couple things. First and foremost, when you have a group of 8 or 9 newcomers like we had that have never played at this level, they just simply aren't very good defensively. There's no other way to say it. Guys are learning. They have no idea how to close out the right way. They've never been held accountable for the most part to defend for 40 minutes because their coach in high school, junior college, didn't want them getting in foul trouble, et cetera. And I would do the same thing if I was their coach. But at this level, you have to be able to guard without fouling, and it's a transition period for everybody. Secondly, I think early in the year, we really tried to extend our zone in the half court where we got out and pressured the ball at 26, 28 feet, and it lended itself to picking up cheap fouls on dribble drives where guys that aren't great defensively yet, although we're getting better, we're hand-checking and grabbing guys to try to not get beat. And we've kind of shrunk the floor, which means condense our zone, pack it in a little bit more. Now, when that happens, you don't get as many steals, but you don't foul as often either. So we've kind of had to go that route at least the last 5 or 6 games. Well, I think we have a very resilient group, and when you have so many newcomers like we have, that usually takes a year or two to get that base in your team. We're very fortunate. We've got a receptive group of kids that are coachable. They've bought in early. The chemistry has been good. So we've been able to overcome some tough spots during games or stretches during the game to stay competitive every night. You know, I use this as an example a lot, but you're down 18 to VCU. That game could have easily went to 30. Instead, we cut it to 8 3 different times. Our team never quit competing. We play Kansas as a top 10 team. They're up 13. Again, we could have stopped playing and competing, and the game ended up 20 or 25, and we actually tied it up with about 5.5 to go. So the other night against gosh, that's all running together. We go down 13-0 against East Tennessee and could have easily felt sorry for ourselves, and we didn't. So with all that being said, I think we have a resilient bunch for our lack of experience and our youth.
What is these last 4 games? You've won them all, but they've all been kind of fights. I mean, how has that kind of taught y'all about kind of margin? I know you've talked about the margin for error being small. How's it supposed to kind of taught these players about?
Well, I think in all 4 of those games, we've done a little something different to win. You know, against Butler, I feel like we won because of our press. Against Tennessee Tech, we had to execute the last 8 minutes in the half court offensively. Against Mercer, I thought that was a team that really made us play against mixing and matching defenses and kept us off balance a little bit. And then the other night against East Tennessee State, We had to do a good job, which we didn't at all times, going out and guarding the three-point line. So each team brought a little something different to the table, and yet we were able to find a way to win. And I think particularly when you're playing in-state schools like Tennessee Tech, East Tennessee, Tennessee State, you're going to get their best shot. You know, I was in that role or in those shoes when I was at Moorhead, and I know when we played a Louisville or Kentucky, those games were always a little more important to our players, and so we're getting the best shot from those teams, and yet we found a way to get through and win.
What are your early impressions of Mississippi State, and what would it mean for this program to start out the SEC play with a win on the road?
Well, they're long and athletic. They've had some injuries, although it looks like their team is rounding into shape and getting healthy. The Ware kid inside is a big, physical, hard-nosed kid. Sword, I believe it is coming off the back injury and looks like he's getting better and better every night. They're going to defend. They go offensive, rebound the ball very well. And obviously playing on the road is always tough. So it's a team that thus far has played a lot in the half court. They're efficient in the half court offensively. They guard you the right way in the half court defensively. So our goal will be trying to get the game to go up and down a little bit more than they usually do. And that's hard to do on the road, but it's a good team that is playing better here of late. And more importantly than that, they have their team healthy for probably the first time all year.
Coach, do you feel like you have a read on what to expect? You've only played one through road game at NC State. Do you feel like one's in Navy and playing in Orlando? Is the equivalent of that?
Well, I think any true home road environment, Rob, is always more challenging. But, you know, when we played VCU at the Naval Academy, they basically had a home crowd. When we played Kansas in Florida, they basically had the home crowd. So we've been in some tough environments, obviously NC State. So I think anytime you go on the road, it's going to be challenging. Our guys with such a youthful team maybe aren't completely understanding of that, but they know how tough it was at NC State, and they know how loud it got when we were playing Kansas and VCU, and it'll be similar on Wednesday.
You knew going in that you needed Josh Richardson to be consistent, but has he been even maybe more consistent or played at a higher level than you thought?
Well, I think with Josh, you know, I expected him to play at a high level and do some of the things he's doing. The thing I'm probably most surprised and proud of Josh is the fact that he's really grasped the point guard position from a mental standpoint. He's so receptive in the film room. He's a guy that asks questions. He understands when he makes a mistake. He doesn't shy away from taking responsibility. And that's not always the case with a guy that's a senior, had good success to this point in his career, and then you ask him to slide over and sacrifice some of his game for the betterment of the team. But he's been really receptive to that, and mentally, probably above everything else, he's been great in kind of embracing or adapting to that point guard position.
Has playing the point affected him in other areas of his game?
You know, I think maybe a little bit fatigue could possibly be an issue because teams can dog him 94 feet when he's bringing it up the floor, and then the way we play, he's got to dog the ball 94 feet at the other end. Now, with that being said, he's playing 35 minutes a night and doing a great job. We'll have to be careful at times throughout the season during practice of trying to limit his reps and get him a little bit more of a rest time, if you will. But he's a tough kid. He's a guy that doesn't ask to be taken out. He doesn't ask to not be in drill work during practice because he's a competitor. So that'll just be one issue I think we need to monitor in regard to fatigue as the season moves forward. You know, ideally you like to play 9 or 10 in our style of play, and now we're down to 9. If a guy gets in foul trouble, now you're playing with 8. But, you know, the guy we miss probably because of the physicality he brought is Jabari more than anybody. But, you know, guys like Tariq have stepped up. Derek Reese is even having to slide over and play a little bit at the the five position. When we do that, it's probably not advantageous defensively, but it's probably pretty advantageous at the offensive end. So, you know, we're not a group or a staff, and I'm not a coach that's going to make excuses and feel sorry for ourselves. We got nine tough, hard-nosed kids, plus Galen Campbell is a guy that gives everything he has every day in practice. So we have 10 guys that are ready to play and compete. We're not going to make excuses or have shortcomings. We got to go hoop. That's just the way it is.
See Brandon Lopez out there shooting shots. I mean, is there any chance that he could be of use this season, or is there any update on his recovery?
No, he'll be out all season. You know, and when you think about it, you know, we've had some tough luck with that point guard position because Brandon's a guy that would have played 15, 18, 20 minutes a night. He blows his knee out. Then you bring in Ian to be your starting point guard. He's been injured all summer and fall. He's out. And so, you know, the biggest thing is Josh has got to continue to do what he's doing and play extended minutes. And then when he's out, Kevin Punter's got to be able to slide over like he has thus far and play that position. I am, you know, and I've said since I took the job over, Armani is my type of guy because of his intensity, his toughness. He's a physical guy. You know, again, a lot like Josh, he's not hung up on the fact that he's got to slide over and play some four. You know, some guys I've coached in the past would be like, oh, I'm not a four, I'm a wing player. And at the end of the day, he plays mostly on the perimeter at that four spot anyway, but just his receptiveness to being willing to do that has been very impressive. And he's a mismatch problem, and I think he understands that. When he's at the four and has a bigger guy guarding him, he gets driving lanes and driving angles where he can get to the rim and draw fouls. And he's going to shoot the ball better before the year's over, too. Trust me, in practice, he makes some shots from behind the arc, and I think it's just a matter of time before he shows some people that he's capable of making 20-footers as well. No, I think the competition is great. You know, it keeps guys on edge. It makes practices competitive, which makes your team better. And we've had a lot of different starting lineups, as everybody is aware. But I think, you know, those two guys have a great competition going. And practice is competitive every day. You got Dietrich is competitive every day with Kevin Punter. So you have competition at all five spots, with maybe the exception of point guard. But Josh pushes himself and his teammates in his own way. So when you have two good players at each spot, guys stay competitive. It's healthy for your team, and guys continue to improve. Well, you know, I think we're, plus one, maybe one and a half on the season, which is the worst any of my team has ever been, rebounding margin-wise. They were plus one. You know, so we've got to continue to become a better blockout team. We have to, you know, not be afraid to hit guys. Our guards have to do a better job of what we call rebounding down, getting to the paint on long rebounds, pulling balls. And that's something that we emphasize every day in the film room. We chart it every practice session, and we've just got to continue to get better at it. But without having the luxury of a real physical front line and not a huge front line, it's going to be something we got to continue to work at all year long. Well, you know, I've always said the way that I coach, there's really one guy that's going to be hard-headed in our locker room, and there's going to be one guy that maybe guys would call a jerk, for lack of a better word, and that's me. And everybody else is going to fall into line. And I think when you hold guys accountable, no one in your locker room thinks anybody is being given anything, that everything each guy in our team gets is earned. That builds a chemistry pretty quick, and I think we have a great group of guys. We've got very good leadership from Josh and Armani. But when you don't give anybody anything, the rest of the team knows that, and you have an instant respect factor for your teammates and your coaching staff. And I think that's what's happened. You know, and our staff, myself, we've always emphasized things like, if you watch our huddle and timeouts, our guys' arms are around each other. When guys come out of the game, they give guys five all the way to the end of the bench, and then they come back and sit by a coach. And, you know, some people may say, well, that's corny, or they don't do that in the NBA, but I've always felt like when you do those type of things and then you emphasize it, if someone doesn't do that in a game, we point it out in the film room just like we point out a missed blockout or a turnover. And when you make sure that that's important to you, it becomes important to your players, and I think that's happened again this season.
Coach,